Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Sociology 315, The Sociology of Work. I'm Dr. Sharon Squires. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This summer we will be broadcasting four classes. Interdisciplinary Studies 336, Perspectives in Civilization on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Psychology 372, Industrial and Organizational Psychology on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m., Social Behavioral Sciences 318, Cultural Pluralism, Immigration on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m., and Humanities 310, Theater of Revolt on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then started over. If you would like information on the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Hello and welcome to our second to last class today. And we are going to be wrapping up our semester, and today we're going to talk about entrepreneurship. But as usual, before we do, I want to go through our housekeeping stuff. I did put some updated information on Blackboard, and so your exam one is still open. If you haven't taken exam one, still take it. That is going to be open until April 1st. I'm going to post exam two by tomorrow night, and that is barring any other Blackboard complications. And that exam is going to stay open until April 9th. So you still have a couple of weeks to take it. And the second exam is going to focus much more on the televised lectures and lecture notes. And so let me see what else I put on Blackboard. I'm caught up with your grading. The only thing I have not graded are things that are extra credit. And if you've had to resubmit a paper, if it's sitting in my email box, I haven't gotten to those either. But remember, unless I ask you to resubmit a paper, which means that I'm going to be looking for your email, I don't want you to send your papers to my email. So if you look at the grades and you don't see grades for yourself, but you've sent me papers, post them to Blackboard to make sure that they get graded. I have given a couple of you a deadline. Today is actually the deadline for your PowerPoint on the current economic situation and the impact on you. But what I've done is I've gone ahead and given you a couple more days of extension. A few people have posted their PowerPoints, and I haven't done those as well. I've seen them starting to pop up, but you have until Wednesday to get your PowerPoint into me. I'm trying to be flexible since this is online, and I've really tried to be kind of loose and free with due dates and stuff like that, so get it in. And some of the early stuff, you may lose a couple of points, but still, you'll get the points and you'll be able to complete the class. And if any of you guys have any questions or anything, just go ahead and type them in. All right, today we're going to shift gears. If you remember what we talked about last week, we talked about sweatshops and kind of cut off before we got to chai labor. And I decided not to pick it up. All the information is in the PowerPoint. And because one of the technicians came in and said the lecture was depressing, and it really was depressing, so I don't want to do depressing for our last couple of lectures. So today, we are going to talk about entrepreneurship. So the last couple of lectures, I'm going to give you some practical advice on things that you can do in this new changing global business world. But let's start off with our president, because recently there was the Summit on Entrepreneurship. And so we'll just watch a couple minutes of what Obama had to say with regards to why this issue itself is even important. So let's go to our first clip.
And around the world, the United States of America will continue to stand with those who seek justice and progress and the human rights and dignity of all people. But even as I committed the United States to addressing these security and political concerns, I also made it clear in Cairo that we needed something else, a sustained effort to listen to each other and to learn from each other, to respect one another. And I pledged to forge a new partnership, not simply between governments, but also between people on the issues that matter most in their daily lives, in your lives. And many question whether this was possible, yet over the past year, the United States has been reaching out and listening. We've joined interfaith dialogues and held town halls, roundtables, and listening sessions with thousands of people around the world, including many of you. And like so many people, you've extended your hand in return, each in your own way, as entrepreneurs and educators, as leaders of faith and of science. I have to say, perhaps the most innovative response was from Dr. Naif Al-Mutawa of Kuwait, who joins us here tonight. Where is Dr. Mutawa? Right here. His comic books have captured the imagination of so many young people with superheroes who embody the teachings and tolerance of Islam. After my speech in Cairo, he had a similar idea. So in his comic book, Superman and Batman reached out to their Muslim counterparts. And I hear they're making progress, too. Absolutely. By listening to each other, we've been able to partner with each other. We've expanded educational exchanges because knowledge is the currency of the 21st century. Our distinguished science envoys have been visiting several of your countries, exploring ways to increase collaboration on science and technology. We're advancing global health, including our partnership with the Organization of the Islamic Conference to eradicate polio. This is just one part of our broader engagement with the OIC, led by my special envoy, Rashad Hussein, who joins us here tonight. Where's Rashad? And we're partnering to expand economic prosperity. At a government level, I'd note that putting the G20 in the lead on global economic decision-making has brought more voices to the table, including Turkey, Saudi Arabia, India, and Indonesia. And here today, we're fulfilling my commitment in Cairo to deepen ties between business leaders, foundations, and entrepreneurs in the United States and Muslim communities around the world. Now, I know some have asked, given all the security and political and social challenges we face, why a summit on entrepreneurship?
Actually started a little bit at a different point, but let me summarize what he says. He actually basically argues that if we want to be successful in the future, it must be a collaborative process. And we started the class talking about globalization. We have to think about our businesses in terms of the world, not just necessarily what is going on right now. And he says it also needs to be a creative process. So in addition to speaking with people, even people that are we're in conflict with, we have to realize these conflicts, all of this relates to the economy, he said we've got to be creative. We've got to start thinking out of the box, thinking about work in the future and what that is going to look at. It's actually really going to be impossible to just be an isolated business person. And so when we talk about entrepreneurship, I want you to think of it, yes, as the one person, but this in the bigger, larger context. All right, so what is entrepreneurship? And Andrew Zacharias, and I think I'm saying his name right, is a professor of entrepreneurship at Babson College. And I found that he did a really good job of explaining what it is. So let's go immediately into our next clip, and then when we come back, we'll try to figure out what this means to us. So let's go to our next clip. I think we're having some technical difficulties. They will tell us when it's up. But basically, Zacharias is talking about the fact that when we talk about entrepreneurship, it's not necessarily just the same thing as small businesses. And so when we, they told me that the clip is ready. So when we come back, I'll go to that next idea. So let's see a good definition of what entrepreneurship is. Okay, I still think we're having some trouble. Maybe the beginning doesn't play. But basically, when we talk about entrepreneurship, what we're talking about is the development and creation of a new idea. We are talking about, yes, the creation of a new enterprise, but an entrepreneur is not necessarily just simply the same thing as a small business person. And so, when we talk about this, I see they're telling me, let's try this one more time. But when we talk about this, we're going to get into this distinction because it's really important. So let's go to the clip and try it one more time.
Entrepreneurship is a way of life. I think it is the pursuit of opportunities. Traditional definitions have stated that is creation of a new organization. That's the pursuit of an opportunity regardless of the resources currently controlled. I think at Babson we take a more holistic view of it. Entrepreneurship is about pursuing opportunities. It is about acquiring resources. It's about building a team. It's about finding a marketplace and a core customer who's excited about the product that you have. Entrepreneurship is critically important, and I think it's important for a number of reasons. First, at Babson, we've been involved with the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor, which is a project that looks at the level of entrepreneurship around the globe. We have initiated this project in 1999 with the London Business School, and we have found university partners in over 40 countries around the world, representing over 90% of the world's gross domestic product and 60% of the world's population. And what we find is that there's a high correlation between entrepreneurial activity levels within a country and their growth in gross domestic product. So entrepreneurship not only creates a livelihood for the entrepreneur, it creates wealth for the entrepreneur, it creates a way for the entrepreneur to self-actualize to achieve their fullest potential. But it also creates wealth for society as a whole, because an entrepreneur who's successful will build an organization, hire employees, satisfy a customer need, buy supplies from suppliers, and pay taxes to support the government. Yeah, there's two types of entrepreneurship that we talk about in the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor. One is opportunity-based entrepreneurship, and the other is necessity-based entrepreneurship. An entrepreneur in a developed economy will have huge opportunity costs to leave a job and pursue a new business. And so he needs to pursue an opportunity that's going to have a huge potential payoff somewhere down the road. An entrepreneur in a developing country may not have as high of an opportunity cost if they're from a lower socioeconomic group. And so they'll be necessity-based entrepreneurs. They're starting a new enterprise as a way of creating a livelihood for their family. It's also true that in developing countries, they often have a weaker social safety net. And so in a developed country, if you're unemployed, you can collect welfare or unemployment insurance, and you don't need to start a business to bring food on the table as quickly as you might in a developing country.
Okay, so when we think about this, it's a new organization, the pursuit of opportunity, acquiring resources, finding a marketplace, and I think also we started a little bit earlier, but one of the things he talked about is that the definition is a little bit unclear. And because we often use the term small business owner, entrepreneur, and so we interchange these terms, but they are related but not exactly the same. And one of the problems in discussing entrepreneurship has to do with entrepreneurial education. There is very little offered in our country, and then what is offered, there isn't a consensus of what it needs to look like. And so when you talk about entrepreneurial education, the first person to really begin to look at this as a field of study was Sumpeter in 1934. And he started to look at it because he said, look, these small businesses, these small entrepreneurs are actually responsible for a good deal of what's going on in our economy. It's not just the big industries, it's not just the big factories, but it is the small businesses that actually bring in a lot of the jobs that support communities and everything. And so think about it, this wasn't something that was always discussed. And what is interesting is that the research in terms of how do you teach entrepreneurial skills is actually very shaky. And I was putting this together, and there are a lot of ways that people have approached trying to discuss what this issue of entrepreneurship is. Klatt, and I'm going to mess up these names, so let's just say Klatt et al. In 1996 said, looked at self-directed teaching. So basically teaching people to take the initiative to put the stuff out there and let them go out and try these things or whatever. But this wasn't the only idea. And so much of the literature is kind of wishy-washy on exactly what it is to teach entrepreneurial education. What exactly are you going to teach? And how are we using that term? Godin said, the essence, I think, is that entrepreneurs think big thoughts and do big things, while small business owners settle, working their way through the day-to-day. So Godin makes the distinction between individuals that are innovative and that are moving forward, and then people who just have a business enterprise for income. You may run a small business, and the way the layman's term is, yes, that is technically an entrepreneur, but the way that the academic literature defines it, there is a little bit of a difference. You're just earning income. You're not innovating. You're not necessarily doing all those other things necessarily, acquiring resources, making changes, all of that. And when we're talking about entrepreneurship, there is a lot of debate. And there is even debate on what you should look at. So some of the researchers argue that when we teach and study entrepreneurship, we should look at the entrepreneur. And so therefore, we focus on the characteristics and skills that make people successful. Some people think we should focus on the organizational creation. And so this is the actual development of this new entity in our structure. Some look at the creation of value. And so you beginning, for example, a new mousetrap corporation, and everybody in the society is dying for your new mousetrap. Some argue we should look at profit, non-profit, when we're talking about entrepreneurship. Some say we should look at the difference between owners and managers. And so there is actually, I was very, very surprised when you do the readings that there is so much controversy, not only on what this is, but on how to teach it as well, and what the main focus should be. When we start to think about it, David Birch in 1979 did one of the early studies, and he found that small firms of 100 people or less actually make up 80% of the jobs when he was looking at the economic situation in the 70s. And this also gave a little bit of a spark to this idea that we need to begin to examine the nuances of entrepreneurship. When we talk about this in terms of women, I always kind of try to throw in a little bit about women and minorities. Little is known about women's attitude towards business development. But what is very interesting is that the Kauffman Foundation did a study, and they looked at 1,000 males and females in high school. And what they found was that although everybody was, you know, a little bit interested in starting their own business, females were slightly less likely than males. So females were only 62% versus males 72% desire to want to start their own business. And so what is the impetus behind even wanting to be a questionnaire? And I mean, I'm sorry, wanting to be an entrepreneur. One of the things I started the class with, and today just seems like it's flying by, and they've just told me that my guest is here, so we're going to have a really good conversation when we return from our break. But early in the class, I had you take a little silly quiz online, and it was your employment style quiz and what kind of person you were. And it talked about whether you were a leader, whether you were innovative, whether you took charge, whether you were a problem solver. And the reason I had you start here is because much of the research suggests that this is actually an important element in understanding who goes into being an entrepreneur. So one of the things that you want to understand is the person's learning style, the person's personality style. Are you a leader or a follower? All of that is going to be important in whether you decide to take that step. Many of you got the take charge, you know, whenever there's a problem. People, this is kind of weird seeing myself, but whenever there's a problem, people run to you to take care, to take charge and all of that. Well, that is actually one of the main characteristics that's found in entrepreneurs. They are not only basically interested in taking the lead, but they are also that position to other people. And so you're clearly somebody that's going to go out and try a new way and invent things and come up with a new mousetrap. Sexton and Bowman said, look, we need to focus on the success characteristics if we're going to talk about entrepreneurship, and then the critical thinking skills that go on in the minds of these people. If we focus there, we're going to be able to give ourselves a better understanding of this process of starting this venture. And so personality characteristics are really important. So even though it was a simple thing, if you are now in a transition, you are at the point where you have to make new job decisions like many of us, then understanding your personality, how you learn and how you work is essential to making a good choice for your future labor. Another thing, and it's specifically defined in the literature, is risk-taking. Entrepreneurs need to be open to open up that parachute and just jump. And basically, when you talk about risk-taking, we often think about it at the corporate level. And so this is companies that introduce new products, basically introduce new ways of making the products. If you can't create your own product, look at how it's done and come up with a better way to do it. And so if you want to be an entrepreneur, that is also a venue. Opening up new markets. Look at what is needed right now. What is needed in the contemporary environment that you live in? And figure out how to get in there. Open up new sources of supply. How do you bring more resources to a particular community? Or organizing and reindustrializing a particular issue. So figuring out a more efficient way to make that better mousetrap. And when we talk about this, it's really, really important, and all of this falls under the category of risk-taking. So as the corporation, you can take a risk, but also you need to take a risk as the entrepreneur. So let's go to our next clip, should you take a risk, and this should definitely motivate you a little bit.
Risk is important in the workplace because we don't have any answers anymore. We had all of the answers and someone changed the questions. And so we must all do what has never been done in order to achieve what has never been achieved. Everything has been turned topsy-turvy. And of course, when you start to talk about risk, it means doing something that has never been done before, and there's a possibility that something could go wrong. But there's also the possibility that something can go right. But if you don't do it, then you're not going to be in the game anyway. If you keep doing what you've always done, you will keep getting what you've always gotten. And we know that that is not enough. Resilience means the ability to bounce back. You are not going to be right all the time. Some of the chances that you will take will knock you flat on your rear end. And you have to be able to bounce back. Resilience is about being able to start over again and again and again with new and renewed enthusiasm. You see, one of the reasons that people don't like to take risks is because there's a possibility that they might fail. Well, they need to understand that failure is not final. In fact, I could say without a doubt that some of the greatest lessons that I have learned has been learned because I failed. Because it was only then that I stopped and I examined myself. And I went back and I examined.
So you have to do what you've never done to get what you never had. Is that what she said? But basically what she says is that you have to step out there personally and take risk and take chances. I've actually been looking up entrepreneurs and looking at what people have done. And if you get online, it's really incredible because what you see are people going, man, you know, they've never thought about this before, but I think this is a good idea. So I'm going to take my chance and I'm going to step out there and take this risk personally and try to figure out how to get myself to another place. So if you're sitting there and this is your dilemma, this is one of the points I'm sending out to you. But when we talk about risk taking in business, this is also really, really important if you want to become an entrepreneur. And it's funny to say this because I've critiqued corporations so much, but corporations didn't get to be big and rich and wealthy without taking risk, without picking up and moving, without going to different resources, trying different ways. So let's go to our next clip, Taking a Risk in Business.
Unity's video series is sponsored by UPS.
All right, Abraham Lincoln, Henry Ford, H.J. Hines, Walt Disney. What did they all have in common? Well, they all failed in business. But eventually, they all bounced back. Today, they're widely regarded as successful people who achieve fame and fortune. But what if they had lost their nerve? Most of us may never file bankruptcy or fail in a spectacular way, but at some point in your business, things might not go as well as you planned. So how can you learn to be resilient and have courage to take risks in business? Develop a success mentality. Thomas Edison had such a mentality. He refused to be beaten down by failure. He famously said once, "I've not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work." Practice incrementalism, taking small steps. Map out a series of smaller projects and goals. Don't risk everything on one giant bet. It's easier to fail and shake it off if the failure is for something relatively small. Instead of investing everything you have in a brand new market, look at expanding with a new product in an existing market you know well. It's inherently less risky. Stick with it and give it enough time, but recognize when it's time to pull the plug and move on. Remember the law of sunk costs. Don't stay with something you know is failing just because you have money invested. Consider that money gone, not recoverable. Do as Thomas Edison did. Seize those 10,000 other opportunities to find something that works.
Okay, very simple, but actually very, very important information. Because when you branch out, when you step out there as an entrepreneur, you might fail. I actually have a small little business that I've had the small little business forever. And of course, the little economy went bad. And so, but you have to stop and step out there and say, okay, I am going to go the next step. I'm going to take a chance. But the reason I like that clip is because she said something really important. Risk is not the same thing as being dumb. And many people stay, you become stuck. Risk is not the same thing as not taking chances, going out there, being cautious. I think I just said it wrong. Being cautious is not the same thing as being dumb and being locked in. So one of the things she said that was important was that it is important to know when to pull the plug. So it is important to know when your business needs to change or to alter or to grow. And a good way to see this as an example, if any of you ever watched Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares, because what is usually the problem with many of the restaurants is that people are holding on to old ways. They don't want to change their menu. They don't want to change their food. They don't want to change their structure because that involves maybe throwing out something, taking a risk, getting rid of something they've already invested in. And sometimes Gordon Ramsay will come in. These people have brand new menus that they just purchased. He throws them all out and he says, look, I know you just spent that money, but it's wrong. You have to start over. And so risk-taking involves business-level risk, but also personal risk. And when you go to take risk, one of the interesting things that the literature talks about a lot is leadership. So in addition to taking risks, you have to be able to step forward and acknowledge what you're doing. And Warren Bennis found 8 skills for successful leadership. Peer skills, which is the ability to work with other people. Interaction skills, which is the ability to not only work with people, but to deal with subordinates and people who are above you as well. Conflict resolution skills, how do you figure out how to organize this? And if anybody, any of you guys have seen the Facebook movie, it was a lot of conflict in there. Information processing skills. How do you build networks and disseminate information? So in order to be an effective entrepreneur, you need to take the risk, you need to be a leader, but you also do need to have good communication skills. And communication skills are not something you're born with. So if you don't have them now, you can still get them. If you don't speak well, go to Toastmasters or something. Take a writing class. But these are skills that are required. You have to have decision-making skills. You know, I have been in meetings with people who, we call them contrarians. Whatever everybody agrees to, they come up with the other side. Or whenever we need to make a decision, we're always stuck because they can't come to a decision. So everybody's stuck because of them. And so if you step out with decision-making skills, then that is definitely going to put you in a leadership position. But also you need to have entrepreneurial skills. And this is a willingness to reach out for new ways. So in addition to, you know, taking the lead, you actually have to see a new mousetrap out there, a different way of doing it. You know, many of you people have been downsized and all of that. Well, go back and look at what how what you're going to be, you were doing is going to be done 5 years from now. Because you're being downsized out of that job now is probably the beginning. Your job may not exist 5 years from now. So you have to literally figure out what the next new mousetrap is going to be. And you also have to be introspective as a leader. And what this means is a leader is not the same thing as a tyrant. A leader is not the same thing as a dictator. And so someone who's able to step back and go, okay, my biases are involved here, or I may need to rethink how I'm looking at this, that is going to make you a much more effective leader. And the reason is because it opens you up to change. And once you're opened up to change, then you're open up to all kind of possibilities. And so Bennis says, you know, a good leader has to be able to affirm values and motivate people. So you have to make people feel good. Have you ever had a boss or someone who was responsible for, you know, leading the group who was just negative, and they actually influenced how everyone else interacted? So a good leader needs to be a motivator. A good leader also needs to know what to do with those polar opposite ideas. How do you compromise? Where do you find the middle if you're trying to govern and basically lead a group of people? A good teacher also needs to have some skills in explaining and teaching. How do you explain to someone what the vision you want them to do? And so these are some skills you need to develop as well. A good leader also serves as a symbol, and you don't want to take this too far, but yes, you do represent, in terms of leadership, your corporation, your organization. And so you have to look like what you want your company to be. And like I said before, they need to reach out. And so when we talk about leadership, we're talking about people who are assertive but also cooperative. Because you can be assertive but competitive and non-accommodating, and that is not going to make you a good leader. So you need to have that balance between assertiveness and dominance and go-gettingness and cooperative behaviors. And so when we talk about leadership, I wanted to introduce you to your competition. And I knew this time was going to go by fast today. But when we talk about entrepreneurship, this is really something we need to be talking about with the youth. According to a Harris 2010 Kaufman poll, 40% of youth ages 8 to 24 would like to do something to start their own business. And so many kids out there are eager and creative. So I want to show you systematically what your competition is if you are anywhere over 24. So let's start off with teen entrepreneurs.
Oaks LLC, limited liability company. We're a wholesale distributed business company. We produce MAC transition visors. These are football visors that transition in color according to UV sunlight concentration.
At only 19 years old, Mackley Harris is already an entrepreneur.
I was sitting inside of my economics class, and my teacher, he had the transitional photochromic glasses, the regular eyeglasses, and it just hit me. That needs to be on the football field.
So he spent his summer in New York at a business camp held by the National Foundation for Teaching Entrepreneurship, or NFTE. NFTE teaches young people how to become entrepreneurs and helps them prepare to launch their own business or run their current business more efficiently.
Entrepreneurship, the word means risk taker in French. So all of these kids have a willingness to, as I said, put themselves out there. They want to take the chance to see if their business will work.
Suzanne Taylor, Director of Events and Alumni Services at NFTE, says there's been a huge increase in teens who are interested in starting their own business.
What we've seen is not only an increase in the interest of the students within the school in taking the Nifty class, we've seen an influx of individual calls to our office trying to find out how they can get involved in a Nifty program.
So why are more teens interested in becoming their own boss? Well, if you've been looking for a job for the past few months, you probably know the answer to that. According to the Labor Department, more than 15 million Americans are out of work. The unemployment rate rose to 9.8% in September, the highest it's been in 26 years. But teens have been hit especially hard. The unemployment rate for 16 to 19-year-olds hit 25.9% in September, the highest rate in history, or at least since 1948, which is the earliest data the Labor Department supplies. A big reason young people are having no luck is because jobs that would normally go to teens, like retail or fast food, are being taken by adults. And while unemployed teens is a hot topic right now, the truth is that, even in good times, teens tend to experience higher levels of joblessness. Recessions just tend to amplify their disadvantages, such as lack of work experience.
So instead of competing at fast food restaurants and retail stores with older, more experienced candidates, more and more young people are opting to start their own businesses and employ themselves.
You can definitely start a business at 14 or 15. You can start a business at 11 or 12 if you really want to. There are wonderful examples of entrepreneurship out there at all ages. And all it takes is some commitment and some passion and the willingness to take a risk every now and then.
Like Evelyn Espinoza. She says starting her business, Hippie Candles, was easy because...
Well, I love candles. And I am an environmentally conscious individual, so I thought organic candles, wow, that's a gimmick.
Evelyn has been selling her organic candles out of her Los Angeles home. And now she's almost finished beefing up her website to reach people all across the country. And as for Mac, he says his idea is gaining a lot of interest.
I pretty much have everything in play, I just have to get my funding.
You have to be passionate if you're an entrepreneur in the business that you're doing, because it is your bread and butter. It's your everyday. You have to live it.
Gary Hamilton, Channel 1 News.
Okay, so what you see now is these kids are having to adapt to the new market. There are no more McDonald's jobs because Grandpa has that job. But most of those kids have a computer. And I tell people right now, if you, every day you don't have a website, you are losing money. You are losing money. That is the easiest connection to everyone else in the global world. And so these kids are tapping in. I actually want to skip over the next video, if that's possible, the 8-year-old. The next video I had, because I'm going to run out of time, but the next video was an 8-year-old who actually went to a labor convention and handed out business cards. And he said, I am a creator, and I want you to employ me in some way. And he's 8. And so when you talk about your competition, it's not just global. But when all of these your baby can read babies start to go to school, you're going to be in a lot of competition. If you're in this class, you're already over 25, you got to get creative very, very quickly. And I want to, like I said, skip over the 8-year-old, but I want to go to the clip about the 2-year-old. Because the 2-year-old is going to explain entrepreneurship for us.
What is entrepreneurship? Entrepreneurship is a way of thinking and acting. It is opportunity, access, holistic approach, leadership balance, and the focus on value creation and value capture.
Imagine. Just imagine, she is absolutely correct, and she is cute as ever. And if at 2 years old, she understands what that is, and if her parents continue to foster that understanding in her, that you are basically needing to take the leadership position, you are looking to do something that creates value in the society, and you're looking for something that brings in resources or mobilizes resources, this young lady is 50 miles ahead of many kids that don't even have this conversation. So if you are a family now, a lot of times people ask me, what can I do, Dr. Squires, or whatever. One of the most important things you can do is actually develop entrepreneurial skills in your kids, because those are going to be the people who are going to be envisioning this future world and this future world of work. Michael says that score.org has the best small business classes. And so if anybody's interested, you can check out score.org. And I want to hurry up and kind of move to the end. I'm going to skip over a little bit about more about women, but another thing, if you want to start your own small business, is the idea of a small business incubator. Let's say you are an entrepreneur, you're a go-getter, you know, basically you have this brand spanking new idea, you want to go do it. Well, business incubators basically are places where you can go to grow your business and nurture your business. So these are universities or corporations or private entities that will come in and partner with you to help you reach your goals. You help them because they make a profit off if you make a profit, but they help you with a lot of the little nuances of business development. And that allows you to be creative and all of that. So simple things like payroll, things like monitoring, things like keeping up with the business structure, these incubators offer that. And there was a really interesting one because I thought their website had some good information. KC Catalyst, and their website says everything you need to know about incubators. Proof of this is that 79 million Americans who plan to start their own business in the next 3 years, 79 million Americans plan to start their own business in the next 3 years, according to Forbes. And when you think about this, many of these businesses are going to fail. And they're going to fail for a couple of reasons. And what is interesting is these are the things that we need to consider when you leave and you want to go out and start this venture. And basically, the incubator company takes care of some of the small things. They take care of your office. So you may literally be a little business inside of someone else's larger office space. So you're sharing space with them and you're getting the benefits of their janitor, their maintenance, and all of that. You don't have to foot that cost. So the incubators help with that. So if you're interested, there are a lot of business incubators. You can go and find public businesses that are willing to partner with you, share office space with you, and do different things like that. You can find larger companies that are looking for streams of investment. So they would be interested in supporting your small business and helping to incubate you because they're looking for other investment streams. But you can also do it through universities. And in another life, I actually was the director of a collaborative interdisciplinary program that brought universities and community businesses and community organizations together. And so we were, they didn't use the term very much then, but we were kind of these little incubators for some of these community businesses. And so there'd be a collaboration. We might do things like take care of their payroll for them, or little different things like that, provide them with office space. Bethany says she recommends taking an internship from an entrepreneur and learning from them in how to get started. And she said it was very helpful to her. And that is actually true. Get out there and see what's out there. And so I wanted to talk one last thing about something before I go, because I posted actually my raw notes for you guys. So if you go to lecture, you can kind of pull up my notes that I then build all my notes on. But I wanted to talk to you about an entrepreneurial venture that I created. And in another incarnation, like I said, I was also the state youth entrepreneurial specialist for Missouri for a short time. And this is actually just my pamphlet. But I just bought it as a visual aid. But what I did was went around and designed and looked at entrepreneurial programs for kids. And what I saw that was lacking was actually a really good educational program in the schools. You know, we had the Junior Achievement, if any of you guys remember that. They taught you how to make businesses. But beyond that, we don't have a lot of resources. So I designed what is called the NICHE program. And NICHE stands for Nurturing Independence and Community Health Through Entrepreneurship. And in my program, all of the things that we talked about, being a leader, taking risks, structuring your business, and all of that was incorporated into a year program for kids. And I found that it was really, really important and necessary because we don't even have the dialogue for many kids. And a lot of times the problems we have are underestimating our operating costs, underestimating our startup costs, mispricing products and services, so really not doing your homework, miscalculating what it means to break even, and learning what that means, how to calculate all the resources you use to produce your product and what that results in. And also a big mistake, and this was one of the things that I addressed in my youth entrepreneurial program, is not budgeting your own salary, not budgeting your own growth into your new business venture. So a lot of times you will see entrepreneurs start a business, everybody around them technically is getting paid except for them. And so in my youth entrepreneurial program, I try to address all of these things that kids would need in order to move forward and start their own business. And so let's go to a break. When we come back, we're going to have Mr. Richard Glass. He is a real entrepreneur, and we're going to talk to him about Glass Hair Salon and how he started that business and find out a lot about how do you actually go about starting a business and keeping it in these tough economic times. So let's take a little 10-minute break, and we'll come back with our guests.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kathy Zimmerer, director of the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We are looking forward to an exciting slate of exhibitions and invite you to attend our exhibitions and events.
Subvertisements, using ads and logos for protest. At the University Art Gallery, March 9th through April 13th, organized in conjunction with the Center for the Study of Political Graphics in Los Angeles, Subvertisements turns corporate identity on its head, subverting the popular image associated with a brand to force the viewer to consider broader social and political issues in today's culture. The 90 images in this exhibit, created by artists from across the globe, include the famous iPod ad, reimagined as a statement against torture in Abu Ghraib.
Please join us at the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We look forward to seeing you at our exhibitions and events.
Ladies and gentlemen, and particularly Senator Ted Lieu and your beautiful wife Betty and your family, welcome to the 55th Assembly District, now a part of, as you well know, the 28th Senate District, which you now represent. Ladies and gentlemen, it's always great to have such pomp and circumstance to remind all of us of the role of government and the important work that we do.
I'd like to ask the Honorable Ted Lieu to come on stage, and with the Chairman of the Board of Equalization, Jerome Horton, a former California State Assembly member and Inglewood City Council member, and, as you heard, a graduate of this fine institution to administer the oath of office.
I state your name.
Ted Lou.
Do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
That I take this obligation freely. With Betty's permission.
Without any mental reservations.
Or purpose of evasion. And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties.
Upon which I am about to enter.
By the power vested in me, I hereby announce and present to all of you the Senator Ted Lieu.
Hector Del Pino. The reason why I came to Dominguez Hills from Animo Leadership Charter High School was because of the great programs this campus has to offer. Also, I really enjoy the atmosphere and that it's really diverse.
Hi, I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics Department, and welcome to the Toros Coaches Corner. This edition, we have the head women's volleyball coach with us, Scott Davenport. Welcome, Coach.
Thanks, Tiff.
All right. Although the team didn't finish as well as hoped, it played probably in the toughest league in America, the CCAA. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
Well, I think they learned a lot about preparation. You know, and we've been trying to impart them certain behavior and how they have to model to improve, you know, each week in and out. But preparation is a big thing.
That core that you're referring to, returning players, is this the year that we challenge the elite teams in the conference with those returners?
Being an optimist, I'd like to say yes. I think the core of returning players, they know what we expect of them. They know what we expect them to teach and lead the incoming players.
And what can people expect to see when they come out to watch the Toros this season?
Well, we're going to kind of focus on tenacious defense. It's kind of what we're going to be known for. We're going to go after our serves. We're going to try to keep every ball alive. We're going to run a very fast offense, too. So a lot of speed, a lot of energy. I expect what you can see.
Well, Coach, I'm sure I speak for many when I say I can't wait to see you guys this season in action. And I just want to thank you for joining us on this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. Go Toros.
Go Toros.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. Had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Hi, my name's Angelica. I'm currently a junior here at Dominguez Hills. I came here from El Centro, California. My major is audio recording, and what brought me here to Dominguez Hills is their digital media arts program. I heard that many students that graduate from the program have gone on to receive awards and recognition, and I'm very happy with the staff and the program in general, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to Sociology 315. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. If you would like some more information on this program, please visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. And welcome back. Today, like I said before, is our second to last class period, so next Sunday is going to be our last broadcast. And we are very, very fortunate to have Mr. Richard Glass with us from Glass Hair Studios. And I said before, he's a real-life entrepreneur. And and so what I want to talk about a little bit today is how you got started. So let me give you an opportunity first to kind of introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, I've been doing hair and makeup for over 20 years. Mm-hmm. I'm the second eldest of 6 children, 5 sisters. So it's kind of how I started doing hair, basically to get them out of the restroom so I can get in there and do my thing. And it was not really a love at first sight, but you know, but it was growing because I got to do their friends and then their friends' friends, and I said, hey, I can make a little change from this, and I didn't mind doing it actually.
Okay, so I guess in order to move them through, you kind of developed a very, very reasonable skill, and just to stop for a second and note that, because oftentimes entrepreneurship comes out of your experiences like that. Mm-hmm. You find where you can find your niche. Tell us a little bit about your business. Tell us about Glass Hair. You said you've been doing hair now for 20 years. Have you had that business for 20 years?
No, actually we just celebrated 10 years, February 12th, mm-hmm. In the same location. But I started a studio on Abbott Kinney, did my craft there, assisting, all that wonderful stuff, ordering products, learning, understanding, mm-hmm. finding my skills, finding my craft, and going to Santa Monica City College, mm-hmm. when they still were part of the affirmative action, and got a free ride, mm-hmm. because I was a black male in cosmetology.
Oh, okay. So you took advantage of one of those kind of upside down scholarships.
Exactly.
That's excellent.
Exactly.
That's also another tip. out there for people. But you said, so tell me how you started this business. 10 years? What was the process? How did you go about
it? 10 years. Well, it was all by chance. I was working at a salon, and then a studio became available, you know, actually right next door. And I went head first. Prepaid services for clients. So I offered clients X amount of services for X amount of dollars, raised X amount of funds, and put my down payment down and got furniture and serviced my clients. And it was, pretty easy to do because my granny, she would always say, exhaust all resources. So I was like, who has more money than me? Some of my clients, maybe. Okay, and I know that they appreciate my services or they like my services, so in that, why not invest in me? And here is the situation, and 10 years later.
So did you do investments and then pay them back? How did that
work? Their investments were their prepaid services.
Okay.
So, yeah. Okay. So you got X amount of service. So it was like a baker's dozen, you know. So you get an extra service or two extra services, you know, if you pay for 10 or 20.
Kind of like the original Craigslist. It was like an exchange. I'm going to do this, and if you help me with the startup funds.
Exactly.
You said it was kind of easy, but that flies in the face of what we understand. So what do you mean that it was easy?
Well, it was easy because it was something that I did. So, I mean, if I was going off and making computers, I know that would be very difficult. So I had no idea how to even start there. So I did hair and makeup. And in that, exhaust all resources around hair and makeup, which would be the clients and the services and going off doing different gigs, weddings and bar mitzvahs or just any type of photos or any type of glam. Yeah.
Okay. We have a little clip from your MySpace that shows what the business looks like. So if we can put that up and you can kind of tell us a little bit about the business.
Okay.
And so they're going to put up that slideshow.
Sure.
And we can just talk a little bit over it. Hopefully, I think we've been having a little bit of technical difficulties, but they'll let me know when it's up.
Okay.
And I just wanted to talk about some of the comments we have. Okay, I see that they've got the slideshow up. And so, where is your business located?
1501 Main Street, Venice Beach, California.
Okay. And you've been there for the 10 years in that location?
Yes.
All right, so tell us a little bit about what we're seeing.
Right now you're seeing the entrance of Glass Hair. That's the flagship stadium studio right there. That's our reception area, bar. Products as well as dryers.
Okay.
Clients under there getting services.
How many people can you service at once? I mean, how?
Well, I've taken care of maybe 4 different people at once, but that's all in rotating, knowing what type of services they're requiring.
Okay.
So from there, back to back.
And now I've been doing some research on you, and you have some pretty impressive clients. Your client range is the entire spectrum.
Well, you know what? I'm pretty blessed with regular people as well as celebrities.
Can you drop some names for us?
Worked with Debbie Allen, Faith Evans, Ernie Banks.
Okay. So it's interesting because when we see the clip, and the studio is really beautiful.
Thank
you. The hair salon is really, really beautiful. But I wanted to talk to you now about the challenges to running this type of business. We are now in a very difficult economic time.
Right.
And what you're doing, your hair and makeup and all of that, that is surplus extra money that people usually spend. So how has it been for you during these economic times?
Well, again, I'm blessed to work with different celebrities. So celebrities actually kind of compensate for the loss of the regular girls coming in every 2 weeks or maybe even 3 weeks. And now they've dropped to 5 or even 6 weeks.
Okay.
But if I have a gig, you know, with a certain client, I have to do makeup, part of a glam squad, and get paid a handsome decent salary.
So tell me some of the, I remember talking to you and you talked about the fact that you downsized.
Yes.
So tell me about that process and why you did that.
Well, simply because of the recession, and we lost stylists. Mm-hmm. Stylists weren't able to pay rent because their client base dropped off.
Mm-hmm.
And so from there, if it doesn't make dollars, it doesn't make sense. That's mm-hmm. what my granny always says.
Did you have to do any other things to kind of compromise during this
time? Well, I mean, just cutting back on, you know, on things that I would do personally, you know, mm-hmm. or things that I, you know, that were extra, you know, mm-hmm. that were not necessary. Sure.
Okay.
Sure, I mean, but you have to. One has to do that. Because mm-hmm. if you want to be here tomorrow, you have to plan for, you know.
And kind of adapt a little bit.
Most definitely.
Sanja says, I see you have your own line of products. Was that more challenging to start than opening a salon? And do you sell products other than, do you sell the products other than at your salon? So are these on the market?
We are available at two different hotels in Santa Monica,
mm-hmm.
at Shutters and Casa Del Mar in the spas.
Okay.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about these projects. They kind of jump my questions a little bit, but they're right there, so we'd like to...
Well, our products are designed to first comfort your hair and take care of your hair.
Mm-hmm.
Blow It, which is a heat-activated blow-drying agent,
mm-hmm.
which also doubles as a leave-in conditioner.
Okay.
It's really, really nice, and it smells wonderful. Would you want to smell a little bit?
Sure. All right.
Smell it.
Oh, it does smell nice. Here, let me take it here so everybody can kind of see our products here.
Right. And G-Force is a mega hold gel.
Uh-huh.
I mean, this will stop a bird in flight. If you ever want to put anything down or braid or do any type of constructive creations, amazing.
Okay. Oh, it really does smell very nice. It actually has a really, really nice...
Cucumbers.
That's what I was going to say, kind of like a cucumbery, melony kind of smell.
Mm-hmm. B4 Bed mm-hmm. is designed for females who have chemically treated hair, such as color, relaxers, or any such thing, because most women sleep on cotton,
mm-hmm.
and cotton pulls moisture out. So this just protects your hair, adds a little barrier if you're going to sleep on cotton.
Now, is this for all kinds of hair?
If you are alive and you have hair.
And so all different ethnicities, everything can use these products?
Yes.
One of the other questions was that more challenging branching out into this than it was starting the salon business?
It was a different task because mm-hmm. it was, the R&D was pretty intensive, you know, because
mm-hmm.
finding out, you know, what works, what doesn't work, what's carcinogenic and what doesn't go together, basically,
mm-hmm.
you know, and what's beneficial for the hair
mm-hmm.
and the environment.
Why did you do this? I mean, was it because you felt there was a lack of product?
Well, there was a lack of product just because of the fact that being an African-American male in Venice, and I do everyone's hair,
mm-hmm.
you know, I would hear a lot, oh, is this for black hair? Oh, is this for other hair? Or this mm-hmm. is for... No, it's for hair. It's a product that works. If you apply it properly or as instructed,
mm-hmm.
it will work.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to make sure that I made a brand of myself because it was needed for me.
Mm-hmm.
To make sure that I was synonymous as Coca-Cola or, you know, or Colgate.
Is that your goal as an entrepreneur?
Yes.
Okay, so you want this little G in the circle to be like the
Coca-Cola. A global brand. That's what we're looking for.
What are you doing to accomplish that?
Well, pulling one of my clients, actually. She's a Grammy Award winning. Sorry, being so cheesy, but Faith Evans. She is the voice and the face for glass products,
uh-huh.
which is the brilliance that reflects you, which
okay.
is kind of a play on my last name, but also putting the honor back in your favor,
mm-hmm.
being the client, because you were smart enough to choose these products.
Mm-hmm. So do you have like a major campaign coming up? Is that...
We have a couple of productions, TV shows in the works right now, too, because we work harder as well as smarter.
Uh-huh.
So in that... you allow others to help in that.
Well, what do you mean by that? Explain that a little more in detail.
Well, others meaning production, and producers and television. You allow them to give you a broader base, such as this show is allowing me to talk to people that I would never even reach.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, we're allowing the TV productions and the movie things that she has in the works.
I remember what you said when I asked you. Of course! Of course I'll come and tell people about my small business. Are you kidding me? Of course.
Of course.
And I thought about it. I'm like, any entrepreneur would have absolutely
I'm jumping. How high? Are we doing double dutch? What are we doing? Let's do it.
Well, let's go back to talking a little bit about these products.
Yes.
Tell me the process. I mean, do you actually know what's in here? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
How did this get
First of all, you find a lab that you trust, and then from there, the technician inside the lab,
mm-hmm.
make sure that you guys get along and that you guys have a wonderful symbiosis going on.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, you tell them exactly what you need this product to do.
Okay.
And mm-hmm. from there, I don't need this, I can't have this. Back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
That smells off. The consistency's off. Color's off. No, it's not really. It's leaving a little bit oily. More residue.
Mm-hmm.
Chalky film.
Oh,
whatever.
Okay.
You know. And from there, you have your bullet points, and you go back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, R&D can take for one product anywhere from 2 weeks to
mm-hmm.
5 months. Maybe a year.
But it's important. You need that research and development time.
You've got to have it.
One of the things the literature talks about is that people often try to rush their businesses.
You can't rush it.
You know, and not take the time to invest and find out what they need to find out. Now, what is your major competition? I mean, I know there are a lot of salons out there, but
mm-hmm.
are there levels to salons? What is the world of hair salons in terms of business look like?
Well, I mean, I do pretty well, you
mm-hmm.
know, but as far as the levels, there,
mm-hmm.
I mean, you can be in small town USA and not have the same service that you're going to get in Beverly Hills or maybe even in my studio in Venice.
Mm-hmm.
It's just things that are indigenous to certain areas. Like, we don't do a lot of, actually, we do a lot of everything. We braid, we do sew-in weaves, fusion weaves,
mm-hmm.
keratin blowouts, color cut.
A little bit of anything.
Yeah.
We have a question. Jeannie says, the Venice Santa Monica community are very local-based. Did you find it easier to market your product to Casa Sutter? Is that what it is? As easy?
Sutter's in Casa Del Mar.
Okay. Is that where your main...
I was under the mind frame that if you get it to those who can really afford it,
mm-hmm.
then it always trickles down to the masses.
Okay.
So, I went there and had conversations with the spa manager, you
mm-hmm.
know, and told her about the products and actually used the products and on her hair. And from there, it was a nice little marriage.
Frank is asking, and I guess we're getting all in your business right now, but I kind of warned you that we would have a lot of questions. How much money capital did you have to start your business? So first, before you answer that, though, what would be the size of your business?
The size?
You know, is it a small business? Are you incorporated? And
we're a small business,
mm-hmm.
Not incorporated. We were initially,
uh-huh.
But my accountant told me that this was not the way to do business.
Not necessary.
Yeah, it's not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just because it wasn't large enough yet.
Okay. Well, Frank says just roughly, and you don't have to tell us, you know, your tax return, but like, what was your startup for that?
Well, basically, I went in with 3 months' rent.
Okay.
Made sure I at least had 3 months' rent, because if I didn't have that, then...
We talking California rent?
Yes.
So let's say $2,000 a month. Let's just say pretty decent, high,
yeah.
good California rent. Okay.
Yes.
So about $6,000,
$7,000 to start? $7,000 10 years ago. Yes, actually.
Okay.
Yes.
And that was able to pretty much get your doors open?
Get the doors open and
mm-hmm.
and allow me a stage, if you will. You know, to present my craft and my skills.
Mm-hmm. All right. Melissa says, I worked for an entrepreneur in one of my first jobs. My employer was a female minority and in the technology field. She saw firsthand her struggles and successes, and it was a great learning experience. And so a lot of the students in the class have noted that they are Some of them are small business owners and, mm-hmm. and young entrepreneurs. And Jeannie asked a question related to something I said earlier, so I wanted to answer it. She says, are human resource companies incubator industries? And the answer is could be yes and no, because human resources tends to do the payroll and all those things for people, but it could be a company that does that and more. So it provides office space, shelters, or whatever. So it could, in a way, give you the human resource services as well as the general operating services. So sometimes yes and no, but not all of them do that. But to go back a little bit, I wanted to go back to talk a little bit more about your diversification. And we actually have a bona fide celebrity here with us, sitting here, class. Mr. Glass was also on Split Ends, and that was a reality show mm-hmm. where hairdressers, and I saw people who were split, not just in I think it was outside of California as well, mm-hmm. and they would trade places like wife swap.
Basically, yes.
And basically, in this wife swap or in this hairdresser swap, they would go to each other's salon and work. Mm-hmm. And so let's go to our clip, because I want to talk a little bit about that clip and a little bit about that experience.
Okay.
So let's go to our Split Ends clip.
Some hairstylists think they're all that. Whether they're from big cities or small towns, mom-and-pop shops or upscale salons. So what happens when these two hairstylists swap?
The thing that sets me apart from most people is I say what I want.
Amanda, why did you say on television?
I will be a Black Paul Mitchell.
I love it.
And have to survive for 3 days.
We're in Southern California. Fake people, fake tans.
These chicks are just staring me down like I stole something.
They'll be tested.
I just feel like I'm in over my head.
Critiqued.
Boy, oh boy. Who put those in? Did someone put those in with their feet?
And work to the bone.
This cannot continue to go on.
Amber is a bitch, and she can suck it.
Do they have what it takes to make the cut?
I grew up with five sisters. I can beat you. Not it, bitches.
Or will they have a really bad hair day?
All right, there was a lot of bleeps there, but it wasn't. So can you tell us about that experience and that show, what that was like?
It was fun. It was polar opposites, you know. Mm-hmm. I've been doing hair 20 years. She's 20 years old. She's fresh out of school, you know, went to school in that little small town that she's from mm-hmm. in Oregon, you know, and I'm not.
Well, there were a couple of things you said, and I wish we could show more, because it was really very interesting in terms of how the craft was done in the two different salons, a completely different approach to doing hair.
Right.
And but one of the things you said was that you wanted to be the Black Paul Mitchell.
Yes.
Tell me what you mean by that.
Well, he has made an amazing brand for himself
mm-hmm.
With servicing products and servicing clients and opening schools and just amazing, amazing work regime.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to emulate that and just become the Black Paul Mitchell.
Is that your plan? You know, is that in your mind part of your business plan?
There are so many things going on up in there.
Uh-huh. Well, it's very interesting, because one of the things the literature says about successful entrepreneurs is that they do have a plan. They kind of almost always hang that little black dress on the door and say, I'm going to lose the weight and get in that dress. And so they say, okay, I'm going to be here in 3 years. I'm going to do this. So that idea is mm-hmm. actually the mark of someone who's going to move forward.
Right. Well, I kind of believe that life is like a stovetop range. You know, you got the two burners in the front and then the two burners in the back.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever is hot you need right now, or is paramount in your world, you need to work with that right there. That's the two front burners. That's the hot S. That's hot bleep.
Mm-hmm.
And then the bull bleep is in the back, where you know you still have to contend with it, but you can do it a little bit later.
Mm-hmm.
So you're still going to do it. So I'm just rotating pots. That's
mm-hmm.
all I'm doing. just rotating.
Okay, and making sure that everything stays the right temperature and nothing burns.
Exactly.
Nothing burns. Exactly. I need to learn how to do that. I need those entrepreneurial skills.
Well, at my granny's house. She's good. I always reference her.
I was just going to ask you about your granny.
I was going to ask you
what motivated you. I think what helped you to become the person that you are.
Well, she's always told us, you know, exhaust all resources, be the best you can be, get mm-hmm. out of your way. I mean, she's always throwing these little words of wisdom, you know, mm-hmm. at you. You know, most of them were a little bit off because she's from Texarkana, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
So they have like a little country twang to them, you know. So, but you just, you know, you take them for what they are, for the bare essence of them,
mm-hmm.
you know, and you make it happen.
And you do throw out those little granny pearls of wisdom.
You got it.
My granny said, if you want to be successful, this is mm-hmm. what you need to
exactly.
do. And what is also very interesting is that the literature talks about successful entrepreneurs do have a very strong support. A lot of times people will hearken back to a teacher, a grandparent, a parent, a local business person in the community who let you work their summers,
mm-hmm.
that kind of thing as the motivation
mm-hmm.
to go forward and then do their own entrepreneurship. We kind of spread all around a little bit, but one of the things you have done, and we briefly covered this, is you've really diversified yourself as a businessman. So you're not just a salon owner, but you also do products, you also do TV. And how do you balance all of those things?
With all a grain of salt, I take this one from my granny as well.
Mm-hmm.
Stay grounded, just wear better shoes. You know, I mean, you know, you can only do so much, you
uh-huh.
know. And make it happen. You just make it happen. I'm not saying failure is not an option for me, but
mm-hmm.
that's not my mentality. I don't mm-hmm. set out to fail. I set out to make things happen.
How do you deal with it if you fail?
I don't want to say I don't fail, but what it is, I just take alternate routes. If this one doesn't work, then guess what? Let me go over here because I know that this doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody already went through it, you know, and told me that it doesn't work,
mm-hmm.
or I've already gone through that experience myself. So guess what? I'm not going there. I need to go over here.
So would you classify yourself as a risk taker?
Most definitely.
Okay.
Most definitely. But they're calculated risks. They're planned risks. They're things that are risks, but not risk to me.
They're not stupid.
Exactly.
You can be a risk taker and not be stupid.
Right. Yeah. I'm like, I'm not going to jump off a building without a parachute.
Right.
You know?
Or checking it yourself. You know, Jesse says, did you receive any help when you were starting out? Are you always open to new ideas and advice from others? Is that your key to being successful?
Of course. I'm always taking symposiums and different classes.
Uh-huh.
You know, Long Beach always has a show every year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got to stay abreast in the fashion world, magazines and
mm-hmm.
everything.
And it's funny, a lot of times people start the business
mm-hmm.
and they lock there. And they don't realize they have to keep moving forward.
They do.
And be innovative. Jeannie said, did the reality TV world help you promote your business?
Most definitely.
Okay.
Most definitely. You know, I was seen by people that would have never seen me.
Uh-huh.
You know, and also, too, it just gave me a different voice, you know, to reach other celebrities or just regular people. You know,
yeah.
I had people drive in from different states to come in and do, you know, get their hair done, you know.
Really?
It was just really kind of like overwhelming. I'm getting calls, you know,
mm-hmm.
people from New York, people from Africa on Facebook, you know, are telling me, oh, you were great. I'm like, wow, thank you.
And he was great. I saw the show. You might be able to find it on YouTube.
iTunes, I think.
iTunes. So it's Split Ends.
Split Ends.
And look up the episode with Richard because they switch stylists from all over the country.
Yes.
And not only was it just switching, though, it was cultures. It was everything.
Yes.
It wasn't only the approach to hair as a business and
mm-hmm.
your clients, but it was also a cultural difference.
And there were no brown people there.
Where did they send you? Where were
Grants
you?
Grants Pass, Oregon.
Okay. What was that like?
There was no Walmart. There were no brown people. I don't say there was not cosmopolitan, but
mm-hmm.
it really wasn't. It was like a small town USA.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
How did they respond to your hair?
The clients that I serviced, they were pretty good,
mm-hmm.
you know, but they liked it.
From the show that you did good, the clients liked it, but we were talking during the break, The owner wasn't that nice. No. That's hilarious.
No, she wasn't. She was just being mean. I mean, just, you know, because we're both salon owners, you know, but, you know, she's a little bit younger. You know, I'm just saying, you know, not as progressive or, you know, as diversified. I'll borrow your word.
Yeah. Well, it was very interesting because I was cracking up. It was very funny, and you were very funny in trying to negotiate this reality. I had mentioned earlier there was a lot of sociology there because there was a lot of social learning that had to go on in order to step in. And that is something else that I wanted to point out is that starting a hair business in California is not necessarily going to be the same thing as starting it in Omaha or Oregon or Atlanta.
No.
You know, some of the elements might be there. You need chairs and dryers and all of that, but you still have to negotiate the entire culture.
Yeah, and there are different variables such as atmosphere, climate, you know, social network, just a lot of different things. So many different variables that come into play.
When you go to get your hair done in Atlanta, you go with the expectation you will be there for the rest of the day.
No.
When you go in California, that expectation is not there. But in Atlanta, you pretty much clear your calendar because eight people have been scheduled at
that's
the same time.
That is awful. So I want you out for a good time, not a long time. I mean, I need you there to get a wonderful experience, get a wonderful service, and then, you know, leave at a decent time, leave a decent hour. You have things to do today.
People, of course, of course. Melissa said she wanted to know if there were any specific business-related issues or problems that you had during your startup that you, you know, now consider as like a learning experience. Anybody run off with your startup money or anything like that?
No. My mom was my accountant initially. I mean, I'm a pretty intelligent guy. I don't trust crooks. I don't trust anybody, basically.
Well,
I'm not saying I don't trust anybody, but yeah, I don't trust anybody.
I think it was also more crossing your T's and dotting your I's as well.
Exactly.
Now, one of the strategies that is talked about in the business community is surrounding yourself by people who are smarter than yourself. Is that why you had your mom as your accountant?
Exactly.
All right. So is that, there is a, one of the rappers, and I can't, no, it's not a rapper, it's actually the Fresh Prince. What's his name? Will Smith. Actually, I saw him on an interview, and he said that's exactly what he did. He surrounded himself with the best people to do everything he needed to do to be successful. And so he actually has a business advisor, and he does not sign anything or make a move or do anything unless it goes through this business advisor.
Yeah, exactly.
This business advisor is paid very well, and so it is in his best interest. He's also a friend, but it's in his best interest to make sure that Will Smith does well.
Exactly.
You know, and that was one of the things that is very, very important in terms of business ownership, to realize your limitations.
Exactly.
And just one of the issues with me is I'm not good with finances. I don't even like to open my bills. I get them, and I kind of collect them for a little while, and then I just kind of pile them up and then sort them. I'm really organized, so my bills are all sorted. You know, and that was one of the things that I needed to learn.
Right.
This is not a skill you have.
Right.
It is not something you like to do. You know, I did accounting for a long time. Find someone else to do it. And it's actually also a part of risk. Now, have you had to go out on a limb and maybe trust people or trust situations that you were not sure of when you did it?
No, not really. Well, no. With starting the business, you know, I went through all the proper channels, you know, the all the different licensing and taxing different offices, you know, I had to go through. Did all that, and it's just pretty simple. I mean, do your hair, pay your taxes. Do hair, do makeup, pay taxes.
And that's another thing about paying the taxes. You're an independent businessman, so you have to allot your tax amount out of your own amount. I actually had a friend who was a consultant who probably almost ended up in debtor's jail because of that. Because one of the things that they did not consider was when they were taking in the consultant money to take that whatever percentage off the top and put it away. And her philosophy was, well, at the end of the year, I'll have it and I'll. But it was so different.
Projected, projected income.
And plan. You have to really, really plan and don't assume it's going to be there at the end.
Isn't that a horrible thing, assume? Isn't there a horrible little limerick with that?
Yes, that's true. That's true. Jeannie said she actually saw split ends and you were fierce.
Oh,
because I think you did some good hair in that, really. And Frank says, does Mr. Glass provide any benefits to his employees? And how does that work? Let's take his question in parts.
Okay.
So because a hair salon is a little bit different, are those people your employees?
Independent operators.
Okay.
They just rent a station from me.
So what do you have to give them in return?
Proper clean station, clean towels, you know, service receptionist, keys, you know.
Okay. But in a way, it works out as if the salon is almost a little incubator for these people's individual hair businesses.
Exactly.
And so, because I have known people who started out in a chair and ended up with their own shop.
Hi.
You know, absolutely. Are there employee unions for hair?
Yeah, there are. But they're mostly for TV and movies and things like that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. So, yeah. Celebrities. Yeah. What tangible benefits does your business give back to the community?
Well, actually, we help youth. We're part of the Boys and Girls Club of Venice. You know, we give them haircuts and colors when they need it. We're fun.
Okay.
We're fun. We help out with cleanup around Venice, you know, our neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever done internships, like had young people?
We have people from Santa Monica as well as Culver City College, Culver Beauty College, rather, sorry.
Another thing, and I think you were just a perfect example of the segment, because one of the things that the literature talks about is that you must be collaborative. And so if there is a university there, or something, or a senior citizen center, if you can make that connection. Sherlevia, and I'm sure I'm not saying her name correct, I'm sorry, do you offer internships to undergraduate students now? So we have somebody who's trying to get in there. I'm not a cosmetology major, however, I feel you have a wealth of knowledge to offer her.
Well,
call them.
Yeah, give her holler. Facebook.
Okay. So, I mean, are you open to things like
course.
That?
Of course. Oh, my gosh. I love it. I love it. If I have something that can help you, benefit you in any kind of way, hello, this is a no-brainer.
Because I think even if you're not in cosmetology, just like the student said, you actually could show someone, though, how to do this, how to reproduce this business model doing something else. Right. It's really interesting because what I've tried to tell the students to do is perceive the future. So what is hair salons going to look like in the future, and how are you preparing for that?
Okay, let's break it down.
It's a hard question, but...
it is. You have to have the spring and the fall, you know, basically, is what I, you know, try to live by. Be 3-4 months ahead of the next person as far as your field or your craft. You know, so stay clean, stay abreast, make sure that you know what's going on in your field, know, and the latest techniques, the latest colors, trends, all that.
Are there innovative technology like haircutting robots that might be coming along?
I wouldn't trust one just yet. Yeah, my head and razors, I'm good.
Well, you know, and most of our labor areas, we're going to have to deal with technology. But I think this one might be safe.
Yeah, well, you know what? I know hair and makeup, people always need to be glamified.
Yes.
You know, and I think that's why I knew I went into it, just because of Hollywood, you know, every kid likes the starry eyes, you know, the whole glitz of it all. And I wanted to be part of it. And from there, doing hair and makeup gave me that avenue to drive down the freeway of glamour.
Oh, yeah, and get to those, the Hollywood Hills. Mm-hmm. I always tell the students, they're here, we have the studio, there are a lot of resources here.
Exhaust
look at
all
what's
resources.
Here.
Exhaust
yeah, everybody is who's waitressing, you mm-hmm. know, wants to be an actress or whatever, yep. but we need graphic designers, we need people who, you know, voice over the scripts. Mm-hmm. It's there are many ways to get... to get where you want, to get where you want. All right, I want to go to the last clip that we're going to see today. And this is a small news story that talks about starting a small business. So let's go to our last News 8 clip. Okay, that's actually not it. But you can get on glasshair.com. That's actually some of his work. Now, mm-hmm. before, because there was a lot of nudity, so let's okay. talk a little bit about that. How I've seen those mm-hmm. designs and all of that. How does that relate to what you're doing?
Well, sex always sells, and that I would like to bring forth the Euro style. Or, Europeans aren't afraid to, you know, to show skin, mm-hmm. and that I was trying to portray that, you mm-hmm. know, showing that I'm a little bit out there, and mm-hmm. I'm not the normal, you know, cookie cutter guy. You know.
Now, a little bit of an aside, then, do you see yourself as an artist as well?
Sure. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. You have to be. I mean, you have to find that artistic niche in there. You got to pull it out. You mm-hmm. know, and in that, allow the business side to actually work as well. You
okay.
know, so it's like this yin and yang. You know, the artist always wants to just do whatever I want to do, but then I have to be, hello, you mm-hmm. got to do work and dot your I's and cross your T's.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is very interesting that you would say this, because I think if you think about your talents first mm-hmm. and what you like and what you're drawn to, and then think about how you can make money from that.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times we focus in on the money, we want mm-hmm. to make the money, but
no.
if you're...
Do something that you love and something that brings you joy, and then
mm-hmm.
it's not work,
mm-hmm.
and then you can make all the money that you need to make at it
mm-hmm.
with it.
I think I do want the clip about pioneering change. And so let's take a look at that clip, and then I'll talk about, we're almost running out of time here.
I wanted to find a solution to a problem, and I wanted to do.
Okay, we're having a little bit of technical problems here, but they'll let us know when those clips are ready. I think we were getting a little bit of clip bleed in. one of the reasons I wanted to see that News 8 clip has to do with they're talking about someone wants to start a salon.
Okay.
So what advice would you give for someone who wants to come out and start something?
Well, make sure that you are at least a mile from where you started.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
Well, I've never gone more than a mile from where I started doing hair. So that I've been doing hair 20 years and people know where I am.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm in Venice. I'm the black guy in Venice. Oh,
mm-hmm.
that's Glass. He's in Venice. You know?
Okay.
So start, make sure that you are close to where you are living, where your home is,
mm-hmm.
where, so your commute is not so vast and far.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure that you find a proper area to house your craft
mm-hmm.
and rent that is not going to cause you hardship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, find your clients who actually work and feels to help you, because I got one client who's an architect and the other interior design to help me design the studio, my studio.
Oh,
so,
mm-hmm.
and I offer them hair services, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you use what you have. The old barter system still works, you know.
It does still work.
It still works.
Still work.
So, I mean, if I have more skills and craft than I do cash at sometimes,
mm-hmm.
you know, so let me use those.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very. It's interesting because everything that I've seen that you are is exactly what the literature says you need to aspire to in order to make yourself a successful business person. Melissa says, do you specifically pick or hire these independent contractors to work in your salon? So do people come up to you do you find them?
A little bit of both. You mm-hmm. know, we find each other on different photo shoots or gigs, as well as word of mouth.
Now, in terms of your studio, have you ever had to let anybody go because they didn't actually meet your standards?
Yes.
Can you kind of tell us, no names?
Well, yeah, no name, but yeah, they just weren't glass material. Uh-huh. And glass material is a brilliance that reflects you, mm-hmm. you know, and we need to make sure that you allow each client that walks out the door, just because my name is actually on the door, mm-hmm. you're doing your work in here, which is great, but mm-hmm. you need to be up to a standard mm-hmm. or a level, and you weren't doing that. You were given ample chances and class and schooling and... And you still didn't do it, you gotta go!
And, you know, sometimes that's really hard because you like them, they're nice, but they're not.
Yeah, but then it all just comes down to you, you know, and mm-hmm. it's your name, it's your thing. And it's not being egotistical or whatever, but what it is just being smart. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't make dollars, it doesn't make sense.
Absolutely, you know? Absolutely. We believe the clip is ready, so let's take a look at our last clip on entrepreneurship.
I wanted to find a solution to a problem, and I wanted to do whatever it takes to end that problem.
In the mid-1970s, Bangladesh was racked with poverty and famine. Greedy moneylenders victimized local villagers who wanted to start small businesses. In one village, Muhammad Yunus counted 42 people who needed just $27 to break out of poverty.
So then an idea came to my mind. If I give this $27 to all these 42 people, they can return the money to the money lenders and they will be free. And that's what exactly I did. And the happiness that it brought to them caught me in. And I asked myself the question, if you can make so many people so happy with such a small amount of money, why shouldn't you do it more?
Since that first bet,
so, this clip is really interesting, and it's embedded in your PowerPoint, so you'll be able to click on the link. But the whole point is the whole micro banking loan process started with one person with an idea saying, you know, if I could lend this person $20 and it would start their entire business, let me do that. So in offering to do that, this person has now created an entirely new industry, the microloan industry. So we are almost out of time, and I want to say thank you so much to Richard Glass. And I hope you got some good tips today on different things you can do. And if I can kind of leave you with anything, remember, everything I've read about business says that the journey begins with that first step. Taking a chance, stepping out there, hanging out your shingle, you know, putting out your little sign. And if you are in tough economic times right now, what do you have to lose? Next week when we come back, we are going to talk about retirement and aging and kind of wrap up the entire class and sum up where we've been all through the semester. And I'm going to kind of review the importance of all the different topics. So if you have any questions or anything, I have been keeping up with the discussion board. I did fix Blackboard, so you guys should not be able to see any of the invisible columns anymore. So let's hope that's all worked out. And I'm going to start posting your discussion grades and wiki grades soon. So have a great spring break, and I will see you guys next Sunday. Bye-bye. We'll be right back.